Today is the video lecture for September 28th, and we're going to continue to talk about partial derivatives of multivariable functions, but this time we're going to consider what higher order partial derivatives might look like. The multivariable equivalents to things like the second derivative, the third derivative from single variable calculus. So let's go ahead and get started with that. Here is our notation for the second derivatives. Now, for a function f of x, y, let's start by defining the quantity that is sometimes denoted f sub xx. It is also sometimes written partial squared f over partial x squared. Now, this one is a little bit, I think, confusing to students because the exponent of 2 is written in two different places. The 2 in the numerator is written next to the partial, whereas the 2 in the denominator is written next to the x to communicate that the derivative was taken with respect to x twice. And that is what's going on here. You take the derivative with respect to x once, and then after that's done, take the result and take the derivative with respect to x a second time. Take derivative with respect to x twice, treating y as a constant each time. Now likewise, if you see f sub yy, or partial 2f over partial y2, this is telling you to take the derivative with respect to y once, then take the result of that calculation, and take the derivative with respect to y again, and total twice. Take the derivative with respect to y twice. But now that we have two variables in play, we have the ability to do some mixing and matching. We don't have to just do xx or yy. We can combine, and we can take one derivative with respect to x and a second derivative with respect to y. There's nothing stopping us. So if you see fxy with x on the inside and y on the outside, this is take the derivative with respect to x, then with respect to y, x first on the inside, and then y on the outside. And correspondingly, if you see f of yx, that says first take the derivative with respect to the innermost or leftmost variable, take the derivative with respect to y, and once that's done, take the result and take the x derivative and mix it up. Now, we had all these notations for first-order partial derivatives, and there are correspondingly a huge number of notations for second-order partial derivatives, and once again, those can be found in your textbook in Stewart on page 762. Here is a very blurry excerpt from that, which I think is almost illegible. Once again, I find that, at least in the mathematics department, these here that have been sort of highlighted, I would say, yes, these here with either F or Z on the top, or these with the subscripts that are numerical, that are not numerical. These are the ones you'll see most often in the math department. I'm not sure what physics is doing in that regard. Okay, so let's consider the following function F of xy equals xy plus y cubed plus 2x squared. Let's calculate all four second order partial derivatives, f of xx, yy, xy, and yx. Now, in order to even reach the second order partial derivatives, we must start by finding the first order partial derivatives. We've got to go through the first order ones to get to the second order ones. So let's start by finding f sub x. Go through, take the derivative, treating y as a constant. So xy is constant times x, and by power rule, only the constant remains. Plus y cubed. This term is completely constant, and so when we take its derivative, it vanishes. And finally, the derivative of 2x squared, by power rule, will become 4x. All right, let's also find the derivative with respect to y. So let's close the eye that we had open last time, and let's open the eye that says this time x is constant. So let's take the derivative of x times y, imagining that x is the number and y is the variable. So once again, because of power rule, the y will vanish, leaving only the slope, x here. The derivative of y cubed, since y is the variable, is 3y squared. And because x this time is constant, 2x squared will completely vanish. So, we are left with our two first order partial derivatives. So now, let's go about finding f sub x, x, which is the derivative with respect to x of the derivative with respect to x, so this function. Now, the y, once again, is constant. So in the derivative, y will go away. And the derivative of 4x with respect to x will be the slope 4. So by taking the derivative with respect to x twice, we have found the second derivative in the x direction, which is 4. All right, we can also, while we're here, take the derivative with respect to x, and then take the derivative of that with respect to y. So we're still considering first the derivative with respect to x, now we'll take the derivative of that with respect to y. This time, 4x is the constant term, and it's the one that vanishes. The derivative of y with respect to y is just the slope of 1. Okay, now let's find the last two partial derivatives. Let's try f sub y, y next. So now we're looking at f sub y, and let's take the derivative of f sub y with respect to y. The x term, being constant, vanishes, and power rule on 3y squared gives us 6y. And if I want to take f of y x, I take the derivative with respect to x of this term here. First one becomes 1, and this time 3y squared is being treated as constant, and it vanishes. So, in reality, we had to calculate 6 derivatives, the 2 single-order, first-order partial derivatives, and then we unlocked the ability to calculate all of the second-order partial derivatives. Now, notice something a bit interesting here, over on the side. F sub xx and f sub yx turned out to be exactly the same number. They were both 1. So the question becomes, you know, does order matter when you're calculating partial derivatives? Is f of xy always the same thing as f sub yx? Are those mixed partials always equal to each other? And the answer is pretty much all the time, yes. So this is called Clairaut's theorem. And we're just going to give an informal version. I'm not going to go into all of the details about what must be true for the functions to which Clairaut's theorem applies. You can find that in the book if you want the formal version. But for our informal version, I'm going to just take two mixed partials here, a function f of x, where we found f sub xy and f sub yx, and we're just going to assume that both of these functions are continuous close enough to a point AB. And this is where the informal part comes in. The book is going to be very precise about what the word near means here. If both of your mixed partials are continuous near a point, then both of your mixed partials are equal at that point. So if your function is nice enough, f sub xy will always be the same thing as f sub yx. So you only have to calculate one of them, and you will get the other one for free, because they are always equal to each other.